Go Zone Racing. Who's read that article or seen videos on Go Zone Racing? So what we would like in racing is that the suffering would be linear, right? We would like it just to be kind of a steady thing across the race and then you're tired toward the end. But it's not, right? It's exponential. It's low suffering and then you get to halfway and then it's like, oh, it's just starting to hurt. And then right, like here is really bad, right? Because you're still far away from the finish line, but you're starting to really hurt. This you kind of accept, right? The last couple of minutes of the race, you're like, well, this is the way it's supposed to be. This is it. But this is the hard part here, because you're suffering at a level that you wish you weren't. And the Go Zone method, what it does is it recognizes this path across a race, and mentally you change your approach to wishing it was like this, to expecting it to be like this, and having strategies to deal with it. Because if you're going for your best performance, it's going to be like that. It doesn't matter. Even those guys kind of like Lemon that you might see on TV that make it look easy, inside, this is going on. Right, Lemon? This big suffering is going on. So we need to get ready for that. So I kind of break the race down to, okay, pre-race, this is where we have our mental thought about how I'm going to approach the race. I have a mental game plan. Do you guys do that? Do you think, okay, first, say you're going to do a 10K. Okay, first couple of miles, I'm going to do this. It's the way I want to feel. This is the way I'm going to approach it. Here's my pacing, etc. And you get all of that prepped so you know how you're going to deal with it. You're expecting significant suffering to happen. Don't expect it not to hurt. That's really bad. Because the brain, if you say, this is really going to hurt, the brain's like, okay, this is really going to hurt. So if it does, it goes, well, this is what you told me was going to happen. But if you think it's going to be easy and it becomes very hard, what does the brain do? It's like, boop, 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 emergency, shut it down, no good, I don't want to do this, we could be at home, yesterday we were relaxing on the couch, why are we doing it? It will really send that out. So you come up with a really great strategy mentally, right? We always talk about pacing in that, but I think the mental prep is good. Then you got the start of the race, you're getting out, you're settling in as to whatever pacing and you need. Then you've got your fast rhythm, which you're trying to just like maintain your groove, your goal pace, right? But then just after halfway, this is the Go Zone. This is where this starts to occur. So you start to suffer at a high level. You must raise the level of your mental engagement to match that increasing fatigue. Does that make sense?
I get this in the 5-10K. But in the marathon, how far is that Go Zone? Like, is it like...
It's a big zone.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's like 10 miles.
Yeah, I feel like it is sort of 16.
Yes.
Yeah. To maybe 22 or 23 miles. Like, that's a real critical period. In fact, when you see the really good athletes on TV that win the races, they often are running their best in the Go Zone, right? There's like a massive pack through halfway. And you're like, well, anybody can win. And then, like, a few miles later, there's like three guys. And you're like, what just happened? Everybody was together. So it does vary by the race, but I think where it occurs in the race is similar. Sort of that second third of the race seems to be where it happens. And what I've found with athletes is if I can get them to raise their mental intensity higher than they think they should, they stay on pace. Because you just need to get close enough to the finish line to really push, right? Like, once you get to a certain, you're happy to push. This is sort of before that. So you need to raise your level of mental intensity to match that increasing fatigue. We often don't want to do it because it's scary, right? Because you're still kind of far out from the race. But if you can do it, because this is where you lose your time, isn't it? Like, this is where it starts to drop off. In the marathon, right, it's sort of 16, 18, 20 miles. That's where people, like, I was so good through 15 miles or, you know, 25K. I was so good. And then I was like, well, yeah, it's starting to get hard.
Can you elaborate on what you mean by mental intensity?
So most of the time in races, you're trying to just, like, run goal pace as relaxed as possible, right? So you're trying not to put a lot of mental effort into holding the pace. You're hoping that it's relaxed. But then once it gets more difficult, you have to engage more. You have to push more than it seems like you should just to hold the pace. So there's sometimes a disconnect, right? I need to push harder just to hold this pace. We certainly see it in the marathon, right? Late in the marathon, you have to put a lot of intensity in just to hold the pace. That's what I mean. Does that make sense? So to me, I'm like, okay, you need to start pushing. You need to engage. You need to go. That's my mentality during that part.
I think one of the greatest things you said to me to prepare for a marathon was start to care what you're doing in those last 5-6 miles. Really care about what you're doing and why you're doing the race. My first marathon was London Marathon. And you go past the hotel at halfway. If you're feeling crappy at halfway, that's not a good sign. But with that course, you come back past the hotel at 22 miles. And he knew that and said, really care about what you're doing. Why have you spent all this time training for it? And knowing that I'm going past the hotel going, ah, they have ice cream in there. And so many people pull out of the elite fields, they would pull out and just drop off there. And I remember triggering that, going, this is what he's talking about. Why did I do this training? What am I trying to achieve? And it's something that has always, always stuck with me. And I try to repeat it to many athletes. It's like, care about what you're doing. All the work you've done, this is the time that it pays off. It's not so much the first 3/4 of the race. It's that last quarter where you can really dial in that kind of positive self-talk and understanding why you're out there. That's when it really makes a difference.
Yeah, because this is big pity party time here, isn't it? This can be big pity party time. You can really beat yourself up. And the brain's going to try to do that, right? It's trying to protect. It's saying, I would prefer to be relaxing and eating ice cream. That's what it wants to be doing. It's like, that's good. But you probably have a goal you would like to achieve. And so the Go Zone Racing mentality is simply raising your mental intensity in this sort of just past halfway to getting close to the finish line, right? And then get time, that's the last part. You can always finish fast. There's free time there. There's free time, because you can go faster than your average pace for what? 30 seconds? 1 minute? 2 minutes? Right? You have to think about that. When we would do 10Ks on the track with the pro guys, we were always calculating that we could get potentially 9 seconds over the last 2 laps. So it's 25 laps of the track, right? So they're trying to average a pace. We always were thinking, I bet we can get 5 to 10 seconds in those last 2 laps. We can go faster than our average pace. We can sprint, right? We can go faster. We can get that time. That's free time. So every time you're looking up and you're pushing, that's free time for you. But it can only happen if you've started this mental game of, like, I've got to raise my intensity. Does that make sense? You see it in races. If you watch races, you know the people who are going in the zone and the people who are down here, pity party time, don't like this.
So what about if, and I'm talking 5K, 10K, your body is feeling great and you go out way too fast. And then, you know, whatever, you're a half mile in, and you're like, oh, shoot. How do you try and, you know, I'll say recover, and then make sure you're going to be in the Go Zone when you get to a mile and a half or 3 miles in? How do you do that?
That's very tough, because you've already made a critical error, right? You've already accelerated the fatigue. You've accelerated it, so now you're going to have more suffering. So that requires a lot of mental gymnastics to do it. I'm not sure anybody knows the exact method. Everybody might be different in how they do it. Obviously, trying not to make that mistake first would be ideal. But a lot of racing is just, I mean, all your races are here, right? You're the only one, you're having all that dialogue in your head. So you have to figure out, okay, how can I recover? How can I, maybe I have to slow down a little bit or I have to relax a little bit and then I can get ready for the go zone, if you can. But it'll be difficult if you go out too fast. Melody probably sees this in her high school kids, right? They just go ballistic the first mile and you're like, what are you doing? Yeah. So does anybody have mantras or mental tricks that you use you want to share? How do you do it? Do you have a...
Suck it up, buttercup.
Suck it up, buttercup. That's a good one.
So for me, when Andrew kind of made this clear to me, and then again, now like it seems obvious, right? But he really made it clear that to even maintain the target pace in that go zone, you have to work so much harder.
Yeah.
Right, and now it's like, yeah, no kidding.
Mm-hmm.
But that really helped. So once I had that expectation that it's going to feel like you're going uphill even when it's flat, that kind of put me there.
Mm-hmm. Because it's an imbalance. It's that imbalance, right? Like your brain is saying it should be this way.
It's so hard.
But, yeah. But you have to rate. You just have to put more effort into it.
Yeah, that's, since I'm rarely the first person in the race, in that like critical like three quarters area that goes on, I try to pick someone else that's ahead of me and just focus on them and try to get to them. And if I can do that and then pick the next person, it's kind of a little motivation and it breaks it up a little bit for me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I've heard Kipchoge say that, you know, when it starts to hurt, he forces himself to smile.
There you go.
And so the last two marathons, I did that. And it's 16, 18 miles. Yeah, this is starting to hurt. And it's like, oh, yeah, I told myself I was going to smile. So I start smiling, and so like I smile for the next 4 miles.
Yeah.
Until I get to 22.
Yeah.
Everybody around me is like, what's up with that? And I found a couple people that are running my pace that I just tucked in behind for like 4 miles, and at 22 they pull off to the water stop, and life is good from there on.
Yeah.
I can see the end, and mentally it just makes a huge, huge difference.
Mm-hmm.
I'm big on mantras. I help coach a cross country team. I'm the assistant coach, and just anything positive that you can tell yourself, like, I've trained for this, I am strong, running is a gift, whatever it is you can tell yourself and like repeat it. Sometimes you have to put it on repeat in the cycle, but I'm a huge fan of mantras because it gets you up the hill or it gets you to the next person you're trying to catch, or when everything hurts, you can just keep repeating that stuff and something happens and you just kind of have this, I'm reading his book, and it's so true. It makes sense that you can like tell your brain something, and even if you have an injury, you can like tell your injury to go away. Like you could totally just run through it, and like I do not, my hamstring does not hurt, and you can trick your brain to believe that your hamstring's not hurting. So I'm a big fan of mantras.
Yeah, it's all mental. I mean, ultimately, you have a certain level of physical fitness going into the race, right?
Yeah.
Then it is all here. And that's what we're trying to do, is trying to get you to realize your potential. And that comes from being able to push. Pace yourself correctly, hopefully, in the beginning, and then really push in the go zone. And once you experiment with it and you try it, for me, I think I learned it, I guess I first dialed it in really in college, even though I was state champion in high school, so I was already pretty good. But in college, I started viewing it as a vote. Because I figured it's always going to, I'm going to have to choose, right? I have a choice. Do I push or do I back off? Because my brain is saying back off. But my goals are I need to push. And so I viewed it as a vote. So every time it started to hurt, I said, I'm going to vote yes. Yes meaning that I'm going to keep pushing. Or somebody comes by, I'm going to vote yes. I'm latching on. They're my transportation, right? Always voting yes. And you have to vote over and over and over again. But the secret for me was I started to look forward to the vote. Because when I was really racing well, I had to vote a lot. And I was looking forward to, bring on the vote, because I'm going to vote yes. I'm so pumped about doing well in this race, I'm going to vote yes. For some reason, for me, that was a real breakthrough. And I rarely have poor races where I don't finish now saying, I did my best. Now, I may not achieve my goal, but on the day, the way I felt, I raced the best I could, right? So whatever your trick needs to be, that go zone is a really great opportunity for you to hold that pace and get close to the finish line.
So as someone who has never achieved that, how do you start to learn to run in the go zone in a way that you can sustain it? Because I basically have two settings, off and high.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And you know, at the peak of my training, I could like muster three gears, but never could I really do whatever that is.
Mm-hmm. I think it's training. I think training provides the opportunity to practice all this.
Okay.
So like in any type of workout, I view the first part of the workout as transportation.
Okay.
To be appropriately fatigued to get into that period where, okay, this is where we need to be challenged mentally. And you have those, right? You have those workouts where it's like, okay, the first half, now I'm tired. So for me as the coach, I'm like, this is where we're supposed to be now.
Yes.
I used to do it with the guys all the time on the pro team. It was like, we did the first 10 miles to get to these. These are the ones that matter. Raise your game here, right? So that's the way I approach. Every workout that I do is, it follows this same pattern as the race. It's appropriate fatigue in the beginning, running as relaxed as possible. Now I'm past the halfway point, I start to raise my level of intensity, and then I try to finish off the workout really strong. So I think the workouts may provide that practice of it. Because you have to practice these things so they become second nature.
I've learned to do it in workouts, but then when it's a really...
Oh, continuous, yeah.
Continuous and long,
yeah.
That's when...
Yeah. You can, yeah. You might just try one time to overdo it.
Okay.
It may reveal something to you, because a lot of times...
Yeah, I mean, I know because I started so late, I never thought of myself as a runner. And so knowing how much is too much and not enough and all that
yeah, yeah.
is really tricky for me.
It is. But experimentation, that's what you have to do. You have to experiment. So for me, when I was in, I guess I was still in college, I was really more of a miler. I was better at that. So, you know, it's just four laps. So for me, the third lap was the one that mattered. That's where the time was made. So I started to really push hard in the third lap. It seemed like I was pushing too hard.
Mm-hmm.
But ultimately, it was the perfect way to push. And then I could sprint, right? So it was sort of just an experimentation.
Okay.
And you may suffer a lot, right? You may learn like, oh, well, that was too much.
Yeah.
But at least you'll learn. Yeah, it's all experimentation.
Is it fair to say that this is really only effective for like a negative split type of race?
No. I think no matter how you race, you will have to raise your game later because you're going to get tired. Now, certainly not going out too fast, like a positive split, it sets you up better for this. Being more controlled early in the race, not making those early race mistakes. Definitely allows it to, it's easier to do if you pace correctly.
I mean, my best marathons have been even split races. I haven't done a negative split, but even split, but you do, and you know, for me, it's like about mile 18, you have to really kind of focus in, and even though you're still running the same pace as you did 10 miles ago, you have to bring it, it's more effort to maintain that same pace all the way through mile 26.2. So it's just, I mean, that, to me, that's the kind of the good way to look at it, is even if you're running even splits through the whole race, it's the mental focus, it's the emotional energy that you need to get through the end.
Yeah, it's all this exponential. You have to do it. So
especially with the marathon, in those last few miles, your brain, as your glycogen's going down, your brain needs glycogen. It's going to be low on glycogen, so it's easy to go to that negative space and start to go down that hill. Well, I'm tired. Oh, okay. I should slow down. That's when this kind of practice in training can really be beneficial, because you learn to overcome that, and you can practice it every time you're out there.
And I think that's good to acknowledge that that's going to happen, right? You're going to have negative, your brain is going to send a lot of negativity. It's protective. That's what it does. It even has a negative bias. It has a real negative tone to it. So you have to overwhelm it with this positivity, right? And you can do that. And through practice, you can do it. And you've all had races that you've gone into where you've been really excited about the race. You believed you were going to do well. Like, you had like that. And then you may have had some races you've gone into and you're like, I don't really want to race, or I don't feel as good. You've had like a negative viewpoint going into it. Which one are you going to do better in? The one you're pumped about, the one you're excited to push. So for me, racing is all mental. It is all about pacing yourself correctly, thinking through how you're going to approach the race, but then mentally being excited to challenge yourself. Raise your level in the go zone and then push.
So I was thinking about how this plays out during my workouts, and it made me realize a question. So if a workout says 4 to 6 times 800 meters, do you just determine how many you're doing before the workout? Because oftentimes I'll get to 4, which is the time for the go zone, and instead I say, oh, I'm at it, I'm done.
Yeah.
So do you need to tell you, like announce to yourself that you're doing 6 before the start of the workout in order to use this?
Yeah, it depends on if you're Eeyore or Elliot, for sure. So for me, it's usually I'll know a little bit ahead of time. So if I am more Eeyore-ish, then I'm definitely going toward the lower end. But usually after the first couple, because usually it takes a couple to like feel like you're, then I would know, like, this, I can do it. But I always am making those game day decisions. Like, I was going to do 6, but I'm feeling kind of tired, I'd do 5 or 4.
But do you make that decision during the 5th interval?
I would usually know a little bit ahead of time, right? Because you're doling out your energy, right? You're across this thing, you're like expending my energy, and you should have some idea of like, I can keep this pace, or I can run stronger, or I can't. And so I feel like it's maybe all of those things are potentials for making those adjustments. No matter what you do, adjust it so that it's the most positive thing that can come from that workout, right? That's how you adjust it. Doesn't mean you're always doing less, because sometimes doing more is the positive thing you needed, right? So you're like, way to go, you pushed through that, I got through it. Last time I only did 4, and this time I did 6, and that was the positive. And then the converse can happen, where you're like, yeah, I did 6 last time, but I really am just doing 4 today because I'm tired or whatever.
I think I just made the connection that I don't really practice the go zone in workouts because I just let myself finish when it starts getting uncomfortable.
Yeah, well, then you might every now and then say, particularly if you're, not if you're Eeyore, but if you're more normal or feeling better, extend a little bit. This all experimentation, right? You have to experiment. You have to fail. I think Lemon was talking to somebody on the run. You know, we'd do these camps in Flagstaff. These runs are hard in flights because it's elevation. And even when people would come that are the fast guys to train, they always screwed up the first few workouts because they went too fast, right? They're used to running fast, but we're at altitude. And I was like, that's great. Look at what you learned. That may be the most important workout that you did was that you would label as a failure, because now you know. Now you know how to distribute your effort across it. So it's all learning. There's nothing, you can learn from everything, right?